Welcome to TV Burp. Dawn has shocking news for Jay on EastEnders.
Okay, I might not be your dad.
World's worst hide-and-seeker on the palace.
Found you.
And Snake does Glastonbury on Life in Cold Blood. Yay! What time the Kaiser Chiefs on? Jamie Oliver had some very sound advice for us this week from his kitchen.
Straight in there. Be quite quick. Always dip away from you and plop away from you.
I always try, but it's not always that easy to control. This week, Jamie was concentrating on the brassicas.
For instance, this cauliflower here, look at the colour of that.
Yeah, it's the wrong colour. It's purple. Cauliflowers are white. Although, admittedly, a purple one would be easier to spot in my mum's cheese sauce. It seemed Jamie was going all eco-friendly. Instead of actually cooking the food, he was saving energy by just doing the sound effects.
I mean, the Italians have a version which they call rapi, which is fantastic. And they'll cook it in a big pan of just a little bit of pork fat, maybe. You know what you do? You get a little bit of good vinegar and you splash it in there.
Yeah, yeah. I'll do the sound effects of my cooking from Tuesday night. Yeah. Mm. Pop, 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 pop. Cold. Earthquake. Those weren't the only sound effects Jamie was doing. It seemed to me he was practicing up to be a rapper, like on the records.
Smoky bacon, chunks of apple and raisins and sweets of red wine vinegar and do that beautiful red cabbage dish.
Yeah, yeah. We put together a little number for him that we call the Jamie Rap.
Smoky bacon, chunks of apple and raisins and sweets of red wine vinegar and do that beautiful red cabbage dish. I want to cook it down, down, down.
Yeah, banging. Yeah. Yeah, the Jamie Rap. If the young folks get behind it, it could sweep the funky house scene. Well, with the celery season upon us, Jamie was getting very excited by a particular part of the celery.
It's actually this part here. That is what anyone that knows and understands cooking gets excited about. That bit here.
See, I get very excited about that bit.
The real hero of this dish is the cabbages in the garden. So I want to go and pick some of those beautiful spring cabbages and then I'll come back and finish this whole dish off.
OK, Jamie. Yeah. Just wait for him to come back. Actually, I'll...
Right, got some lovely cabbages. So what I'm going to do is just trim this all up. And this spring cabbage here, just cut the stalk off. Like that.
Bit naughty, just a bit of fun. Oh, that reminds me, it's about this time that I pull on this invisible thread, which is attached to Tanya off EastEnders' thumb, five times. One, two, three, four, five.
Need to know what's going on, don't I?
Yes, EastEnders. And I was disgusted to see Christian relieve himself in the kitchen sink.
You still think they're giving us a free?
Okay. I've got a talk to them,
you know, with the success of Cell Block H, the musical, I was thrilled to see rehearsals get underway for EastEnders, the musical.
We've got something to tell you.
Whatever it is, I don't want to know.
Max cheated on Tanya with Stacy, breaking his son's heart, losing the respect of everyone on the square. Oh, it was a jolly EastEnders this week. I tell you, it was nice to see Jay and Dawn having a little fun, playing that game, run around the room, turning the lights on and off. Come on, Dawn, let's have a go. Brilliant fun, that. All right, Dawn, a joke's a joke. I sometimes wonder whether EastEnders should come with some sort of parental warning. I mean, some of the images. It's too much. Ian Beale in a pair of black pants. Now, I wonder what it'd be like if you got married to yourself. A bit like that, I suppose. Of course not. This was the winner of Ladette to Lady. And it's been a long journey for the Ladettes. They've learnt a lot.
The girls must each make an arrangement for the graduation ceremony. And Holly is already struggling with the names of certain flowers.
What does it start with? I might get it.
L.
Lilies. No, I'm joking. Lithuanians.
Yeah. We've got a bunch of Lithuanians in our garden. Oh, they do smell nice. So it came time for the debriefing and an interview with Mrs. Harbord. Glamour model Louise came in for a bit of a dressing down over her topless work.
Even if I was to continue the modelling, it doesn't last forever, and I've realised that I do have to get some qualifications.
This needs to go back to its owner.
Let's close that.
That's a start.
I was wondering when that got to. Keep some more nice and neat. Her work done for the day, Mrs. Harbord then took her two other hairstyles out for a walk. And so to the big day, and the winner was Nicole. But the others didn't go home empty-handed. No, they got a specially printed certificate.
All three finalists received their diplomas for what they've achieved at Eggleston Hall.
Thank you, Mrs. Hopkins.
Holly, this is to say that you are a lady from Eggleston Hall.
Thank you so much.
Word processing, click, Ladette to Lady, certificate, click, and print. There we are. I've got one too, but I didn't do the course. Which brings us to our TV highlight of the week. TV highlight of the
week. Hello.
All right.
Holby City now, and poor old Jack was in a bit of a state. She'd forgotten how to use a phone. No, it's knock-knock for doors. Yeah, ring-ring for phones. Yeah, well, she was all of a jitter because the microwave exploded.
Can you get out the fire blanket? No!
What could cause a big explosion like that?
OK, I can't lie. I put a baked potato in. And you have to watch them because they can explode, but I thought it'd be fine for 10 minutes, so I turned it up to high.
Yeah, you do have to be careful with those jacket potatoes because they're liable to explode. Oh, thank you. Elsewhere on Holby, there was... Chucking potato! Everybody get down! But it seems it was a false alarm. Which brings me to freaky eaters, those nutty noshers who don't eat proper like us. This week, it was the turn of Peter. And what was his food addiction?
There's just one thing that stops him leading a happy life. Pete is addicted to meat.
Meat! And not just any old meat.
Every day I eat gammon.
Gammon!
Sausages.
Sausages!
Bacon.
Bacon!
Beef burgers.
Beef and burgers!
Chicken.
Chicky chick! Why do I do that? So naturally, our food and psychology experts want Pete to eat more fruit and veg. And Natalie is keen to point out the positives of fruit.
The oranges and these things.
Plums.
Plums. Oh, wow.
Yeah.
They're huge.
I swear. They're different sizes and colours, plums.
Yeah. I can certainly vouch for that, but we'll move on. What I like about Freaky Eaters is the little stings they use to break up the show. I particularly liked Mr. Broccoli Carrot Face. Mr. Broccoli Carrot Face is nice, but then last week they had Crisp Man. I like Crisp Man, and I like Mr. Broccoli Carrot Face. But which is better? There's only one way to find out. TV Burp, Randy Skeletons on A Place in the Sun.
And a very...
Sandwich sticks its tongue out on Emmerdale. And Ian Beale gets bad reaction to his pants on Primeval. I was most surprised to see Jane Torvill wearing Ian Beale's black pants this week on Dancing on Ice.
Well, sometimes I go out bouncing.
Saucy. I think it must have put the other dancers off a bit. I mean, Greg Radetzky and partner Christina went plum crazy. Looks like he's building up to something. Where did she come from? It's ice dancing, not crazy golf. Linda upset Daniel when, during rehearsal, she must have been hungry or something, she bit him.
But Linda's confidence is further shaken when their run of bad luck continues.
Right on the bum! Thankfully, they managed to get it together for the show. Relax. Here, I learned the sign language for sun on Corrie this week. Yeah, it's this. Yeah, Sean showed me.
He's escaping!
My light! He's not right! He's my son!
Son! Yeah, what you also probably didn't know is that Coronation Street provides a lot of the animal noises for Wild at Heart. Mm. If it's an elephant, they get Dev. And if it's a pig, they get Steve. I think Steve must have been Dan Nando's or something because his breath seemed to really put Liam off. Nando breath. The growing concern for Amy Winehouse finally hit Coronation Street this week.
Amy! 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 Amy, where are you?
Amy, do you want to go for a kebab?
No, no, no.
Yeah. Mm. I tried to make her go for a kebab, but she said no, no, no. Well, this week on Life in Cold Blood, David Attenborough was looking at snakes.
Some can flatten their bodies so that they catch the air beneath them and glide.
As a matter of fact, Dave has been trying to get his clips on TV Burp.
We hadn't got the eating shot, but it's a start. And then the camera is set off again by a second chipmunk behaving very strangely. We showed the recording to Harry and he was fascinated.
Don't flatter yourself. Dave then went on to tell us about a snake that ate crabs. Surely for a snake to eat a crab, that must be quite a tricky thing to pull off.
Crabs are not easy to tackle. They're strong, armour-plated and covered in spines. For a snake to tackle one of these would be like me trying to eat a lobster twice the size of my head with my hands tied behind me.
Yeah, it's quite tricky. Yeah. And for pudding, I've got to get the lid off a Muller light just using my nose. But the big question for all of us is probably which snakes are harmless and which are deadly poisonous. Well, it's all in the markings.
These two snakes look very, very similar. And they both occur here in the southern United States, so you're quite likely to meet one or the other here. One of them, however, is harmless. It's called a king snake. The other one is a coral snake and highly venomous. One bite, certain death.
Yeah, one's harmless, the other's highly venomous. But which is which? There's only one way to find it! Oh, we've already done that. Well, Dave?
And this one has red and black. So I guess that's a king snake. We'll see.
Dave, we swapped the...
God. Sorry, Dave. Sorry about that, should have told you. Emmerdale now, and Val had a recurrence of her old trouble.
I refuse to step back on that emotional roller coaster for something so silly as a misunderstanding.
Oh, it's a misunderstanding, is it? So, do my ears have cataracts too?
Ear cataracts?
Ear cataracts?
Ear cataracts.
Ear cataracts.
American Princess now. And this week, the wannabe princesses were shown how to paint and sing, just like all the royal princesses. Their tutor is top society painter, apparently, Jeff Stoltians, who demonstrates his art by painting a picture of Paulie.
First of all, mix a few colours, which I think I see in Paul's face,
if you can spend 5 or 10 minutes just getting a sort of basic pool of colour.
Yeah, I've got the finished article here. Yes. Yeah.
Is that one of mine?
Thence comes the singing, and who do they get to teach them?
May I please introduce you to your singing coach for today, international soprano, Gillian Humphreys.
Never heard of her. Now, be fair, you remember Gillian. She had that big hit with the Pa-Oo song.
Pa-Oo.
Song. I'd like to hear a little bit more of that. Well, we can. It's a prestige booking for us, ladies and gentlemen. Yes, it's Gillian Pa-Oo Humphreys. Time for see you next week. Gillian, what's your favourite internet search engine?
Pa-Oo.com.
Well, there's stuff coming up next to make Harry's hair curl as Jeff Goldblum flies in. Girls Aloud perform and Jane Middlemiss and Christopher Biggins get swinging. It can only be Ant and Dec's Saturday Night Takeaway next tonight. Or check out the world's craziest police chases over on ITV4.
On Lewis.
Sarah Creel. Inspector Lewis, Oxford, please.
Police interview in a bath on the bill.
The tape.
And Gail falls in love with a banister on Coronation Street.
Look. I'm sorry I was a bit full on. But you've had days to think about this.
I'm sorry too. Well, last week we revealed how they got the sound effects for Wild at Heart. Basically, they get Dev to do the elephant. Steve McDonald to do the pigs.
Hi, 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 hi.
Now, if they need a dolphin, it's straight to the Royal today. Yeah, they've got a sheep there too. And a dog. So it's, here, and a there, here, Vera, everywhere, with a
hi, hi,
here, and a
hi, hi,
there, here, there, everywhere,
hi, hi,
with a here, and a there, here, there, everywhere, with a everywhere up. With a oh. Here and a oh. There. Here. Oh. There. Oh. Everywhere. Oh. Steve McDonald. And a what did you get the idea for that? The Royal Today has really pepped up the daytime schedule, which was badly needing a new soap. And charge nurse Adam has a special system. For him, it's run, shout, pass wind.
Heather, crash call.
You may not know, but the Royal Today is the hospital of choice for Her Majesty the Queen.
How's your health been, gentlemen?
Not so bad.
Have you been taking any medication, please?
Well, yes, I have something for heartburn, and then something for constipation.
Get well soon, ma'am. Let's hope Her Majesty fared slightly better than this man, who had a case of rather bad timing.
At last. Can we go now?
And do you ever ask someone out and realise you've made a mistake?
Hey, can I have a go if you like? Show you what to do.
Oh, I'm not sure I should while I'm on duty.
What time are you off duty, then?
Well, since you ask.
Oh, actually, I don't feel very well.
They'd also admitted a magician by the name of,
It's magic.
It's more than magic. It's Mysterioso.
Right. Well, let's take a look at you. I'll take this from you. Hey! Magic.
That's more than magic. It's Mysterious. Could I have some water?
Hey, there's my card. How did you do that?
It's magic?
It's not magic.
Mysterioso!
Mysterioso, of course. Poor Mysterioso, though. Life hadn't always been that easy for him.
Are you all right? I don't like hospitals. The last time I was in one, I lost my wife. Not what you'd call a magic moment.
Not magic, no. Mysterioso. It seemed he'd caught some sort of bird disease off one of his doves. Sad when a pet gets sick. You'll try anything to help.
Does Maurice use a parrot or any birds in his act?
He's got the doves. He'll show you if you want. He pulls one out the top hat.
And have there been any problems with them recently?
Bianca died last week. She's gutted. He even tried to give her the kiss of life. Going into a little beak.
Time to find out what the problem was for the nutty nosher on this week's Freaky Eaters.
She's quite a party girl, but there's a shadow over Joanne's fun-filled lifestyle. For 24 years, she's lived mostly on bread.
Mostly.
Unable to go near fruit, vegetables or meat, the only food she can eat to accompany her bread are tin tomato soup.
Tin tomato soup!
Spaghetti hoops.
Hoopy hoops!
Crisps.
Drinks!
Drink a Slim Fast, or she'll do something like that.
A Slimmy Thump! A Slimmy Thump! A Slimmy Wump Wump Wump! Slimmy Wump! Slimmy Wump! Slimmy Wump Wump Fast!
If they stopped making bread, she would just die.
She might die, or she might try eating something else. One of the two. So she's addicted to bread, which, of course, is traditionally made from wheat.
Now, I know you love bread, and it appears from the bloods that we've done that you are actually intolerant of wheat.
Addicted to bread, allergic to bread. Uh-oh. Or in the words of the Freaky Eater show... crumbs! And... help! Or in the words of TV Burp... perhaps that's a bit harsh. I mean, food expert Natalie Savona and psychologist Stephen Breyers got to work on her. And the first step, as always, is out with the old.
It's goodbye to the tin soups and spaghetti hoops, high in salt and sugar, that have been Joanne's only source of food beyond bread.
I'm save that for later. Here, what's Peter Jones been up to since Dragon's Den came off the air?
What happens when you have a poo?
Sorry, I didn't quite catch that.
You can't have a poo. You can only do a wee.
That's right, he's come up with a brand new format. American Inventor. Well, in American Inventor, various hopefuls show their inventions to a panel of successful businessmen in the hope that they'll back them. Completely different from Dragon's Den. So, let's have a look at the inventions.
It's very simple. You just take it out, place it on yourself, and it doesn't matter whether you spill ketchup on yourself or that special sauce or mustard. No problem with Auto-Bip.
Yeah, ketchup, mustard, daddy sauce, coffee. Maybe not coffee. But the surprise hit of American Inventor was the therapy buddy.
My name is Richard Coppell, and if you don't know that this is my therapy buddy, then where have you been? This is more than just a cuddly toy. It's a very soft, gentle creature that when you touch its toes, it reminds you...
Everything is going to be all right. Yeah, the therapy buddy. When I first saw it, I thought, oh dear, Zippy's died. But no, it's a therapy buddy, and it's now available in two different names.
I call this Peter and Simon.
Peter Therapy Buddy and Simon Therapy Buddy. Both good. But which is better? Peter Therapy Buddy or Simon Therapy Buddy? There's only one way to find out. TV Burp. Matching scalp and jumper on Holby.
I thought maybe we'd go to have a coffee, obviously, when you're on a break.
Invisible horse on a place in the sun.
Let's get inside.
Not overlooked from anywhere.
And Lady Post's invisible letter on Corrie. In it goes. Well, I was most surprised to see Heather from EastEnders swimming on Life in Cold Blood this week. Of course it wasn't Heather from EastEnders. Really. No, it was a great big crocodile, because this week Dave Attenborough was looking at armour-plated giants. And you've got to hand it to Sir Dave, 81 years old and still finding time to wind up an alligator with a stick.
I think that was pretty clear.
A bit childish. The programme was in two halves, the crocodiles and alligators and the tortoise and turtles. Of course, tortoises are best known for being slow, as well as being tasty. But are they slow or just plain lazy? What would be a good way to find out? Well, give them a reason to move fast, like a fire. Fire! Fire! Oh yes, they'll move fast when they have to. They're lazy, basically. So, where do tortoises like to live? Well, I was surprised to see that Dave keeps one up his nose. He showed us with a special nasal camera.
And now, tissue.
I'll save that for later. So they live up noses, but what do they wear? Well, there's the shell, obviously. And for special occasions, how about a yellow roll neck?
Of course, when your head is inside your shell, you can't see whether your attacker has gone or not.
Or for a more formal occasion, how about a nice hat? But of course, Dave being Dave, it didn't take him long to get round to the tortoise's sex life.
Having your body encased in shell obviously brings problems, and one of them is how do you mate? Making love in a suit of armour is not easy.
No, it's no use. It's not working for me.
Hey, Aaron, have you seen RBC this week?
Brian? They told me it was Holly Willoughby.
There was a clever bit of detective work this week on doctors.
Hiya. Let me guess, you had Rice Krispies for breakfast this morning.
How did you know that?
Very strong powers of deduction. And you got a little crispy.
Oh,
ray.
No.
Guess what I had for breakfast?
Fry up.
No. If you look closely. Sugar puff. Oh, I love doctors. Because they turn up people suffering all sorts of different diseases. I mean, take this fellow with questionnaire's disease. That condition where you can only communicate in questions.
Arthur?
What are you doing here?
It's about that young woman.
Where is she? Can I see her?
Well, I'd have to ring her first.
Did she say anything to you? About me, did she?
Well, I didn't know whether to believe it.
But don't you see it?
Had a nice long sleep.
What time was it?
Six.
So what are you going to do now? Keep handing out your leaflets?
Do you think I should?
I just said you'd got pneumonia.
Where's my suitcase?
A sad case of questionnaire's disease. Well, I'm pleased to say he's made a full recovery and is here now. Yeah, hello, Arthur.
Are you talking to me?
Yeah, I'm so pleased you could make it along tonight.
Are you now?
You're looking a lot better.
Am I?
All right, OK, you watch much telly?
Why do you ask?
What's your favourite programme?
Question Time.
Now, have you ever wondered what's going on in Nick...
Where's my suitcase?
Just followed it. EastEnders now. And it's nice to see relative newcomer Christian has settled into the square so well. He certainly always seems so happy. This week, and I don't know about you, but I like those cards that make a noise. They're a bit more expensive than the other cards, but you open them up and they might sing a song, or it might be Del Boy off Only Fools and Horses. Well, Gary got one of those too. Slightly cheaper end of the market.
Oh, thanks.
Nice card. A bit more expensive than the other cards. Elsewhere on the square, Phil and Shirley had a full-scale papier-mâché fight. It did look like fun.
No, you wouldn't dare. You wouldn't dare.
Ah!
cringe!
Well, this week saw the last instalment of American Princess. Hooray! Don't be nasty. It was the last week and Mr. Paul Burrell was on particularly cheeky form.
Would you like to step forward and take a look at this?
Sure.
Saucy. Yes, the last episode, and thus we would find out who was to be crowned American Princess. I can hardly wait, but I'll manage. Yes, it was time to say farewell to the girls' high society partners. What was nice was that all the lads bought the would-be princesses a parting gift. So, Ben, what did you get Jasmine?
Oh, it's got a bunch of little compartments. I never had a little jewelry box.
I got her a white leather jewelry box.
A jewelry box, how romantic. Theo, what did you get Clarissa?
I bought Clarissa a tea set.
Tea set? Not as romantic, but still a lovely present.
I got a present for Cassie, which was a metronome.
That's very nice.
That's very nice. Lovely romantic metronome. No, they're all nice guys. They took the girls out to see the sights before the big prize giving.
Hi, Theo.
Hello. Nice to see you. I took Clarissa to Hampstead Heath, Parliament Hill, actually, which is a famous spot in London for kite flying.
Yeah, Hampstead Heath, of course, famous for kite flying. George Michael likes to fly his kite up there. As do other men, like to go up there, fly their kites. Afterwards, they zip up their kites and drive home. And so it goes on. Which brings me to our top three campus waiters of the week. At three, the slightly camp waiter on Waterloo Road. At number two, it's Flandreau's slightly camper waiter on Coronation Street.
Oh, right, so when there's no job for you next week, no complaints then either.
Won't worry me, love. Manchester's full of restaurants. Get another job like that.
This week's number one, the campus waiter of the week, is the camp waiter on Doctors.
Risotto and veal for me.
A la Milanese or a la Romana?
Milanese. No, just some water.
Still all sparkling.
So, to sing us out, ladies and gentlemen, Britain's number one campus waiter from Doctors, James!
Oh, 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 let's go fly a kite to the highest height. Let's go fly a kite and send it soaring off through the atmosphere. Where the air is clear, ooh, let's go fly a kite.
There's your kite. That's all from us. See you next week.
Well, the boys are back next here. It's Ant and Dec's Saturday Night Takeaway. Then, for one contestant, there's a possible huge amount of money to be won in spitting distance. Jewel is at 8:30. And that's followed by a guilt fest, and it's a total pleasure. The music begins at 9:30.
Wonderland.
But it's how good they are.
Archaeologist looks a bit like a peacock on Time Team.
And a quick look at
and rather lewd suggestion from Superintendent Heaton on the bill.
Catch you two in the rear yard in 5 minutes.
That's illegal. Crafts, and what's your definition of beautiful?
Now, day one here at Crafts obviously belonged to the toy and utility groups. They began arriving as the sun rose over the beautiful NEC here in Birmingham.
Yeah, it is nice, that. It is nice. But some of you are thinking, Crafts? What's Crafts? Well, let's let Crafts itself do the talking. $23,000. 4 days. 1 best in show. Crafts. Yes, yes, that clip carries on with a few more Crafts statistics. 2,000 tons of dog mud. 600 local lampposts soil. 23,000 people who look a bit like their dogs. Crafts. I was most surprised to see Bungle off Rainbow taking a nap whilst the dogs were being judged. Oh, Jeffrey, I'm very tired. It was a high-octane event. Nerves were jangling, but there was no need for Peter Purvis to diss co-presenter Claire Balding.
Is that Claire?
Don't think so, no. I must say, though, as a dog owner, it's always nice to receive a compliment.
This is a big moment. It is. It's Fabulous Willie. Fabulous Willie's got it.
It's time to have a look at who the nutty nosher was this week on Freaky Eaters.
Kerry has an embarrassing secret. For the last 15 years, her diet has consisted almost entirely of meat and potatoes.
No, I'm not doing that this week. Sorry, no. It's ridiculous. No, it's ridiculous. Turn it to one side and shout, you mate. No, in fact, we'll skip Freaky Eaters altogether. We won't do that. No, we'll go straight on to... straight on to Coronation Street, please. Yeah, yeah. Mm. Corrie now. And Kirk was in a good mood.
I'll have to leave the cleaning till I get back. Hey, but if I get this job, we're definitely having steak.
Steak!
Chicken.
Chicken wing!
Sirloin.
Sweet snake noin!
Nut-free cereal.
Nut-free cereal in the bowl!
Is any of those butties going?
But bird!
I smell burning.
The chips!
Burning chippy chips!
Bacon, no butter.
Bacon, bad, no butter!
And a cake afterwards.
Cake afterwards!
Eat your dinner off this floor. Oh, 3 courses.
3 courses, dinny win, dinny win, dinny win, 3 courses, dinny win, dinny win! Ah, those tricks! Those tricks! I'm trying to do that. Apologies. Elsewhere on the street, David was having a bad week. He'd got the words to a Christmas song slightly mixed up.
He never disappointed me.
David the Big Disappointment.
Had a very shiny nose. David the Big Disappointment. He was a disappointment, yeah. He had a big argument with Mum Gail. And it all came to a head with her falling down the stairs. Well, I think it was Gail.
You're not going anywhere!
No, why? You scared I might kill myself?
Frankly, yes!
Are you a blood or care?
I did it because I love you!
I hate you!
Could have been a stump person.
I'm really so tired. It's going to be all right, darling. Everything's going to be all right.
She's fallen downstairs and she's...
What? No, I'm fine, Audrey. Yeah, I took that bottom step a bit hard, but apart from that, I'm good to go. Let me know if you need any more stunts, will you? Oh, sorry about the black marks on the wall. Should come off with a bit of jiff. The Royal today has really pepped up the daytime schedule, which was badly needing a new soap. And Nurse Pearl was carrying something around in a jiffy bag.
Well, hello there. Well, fix your face. I wish all those men were lusting after me.
I wonder what she's got in the jiffy bag. Let's have a look. First, my hand. Then there was the case of a prisoner who had hidden a mobile phone in a rather unusual place.
Yes, it was a vibration. There it is again.
Oh, God. All right. It's a phone. Won't be jacked, sir.
Oh, the vibration.
Yeah, incoming call. I'd answer it if I could. Yeah, the future might not be orange after all. Now, I don't know about you, but I'm never sure whether to say she is going to be OK, isn't she, or she will be OK, won't she?
Thank you, Mrs. Beecham. Can you arrange a CT scan? She's going to be OK, isn't she? I mean, she will be OK, won't she?
She can be, can't she? Or she might not be, mayn't she? This was Holby, and there was a poor fellow on one of the wards who seemed to be turning into George the Hippo from Rainbow.
Oh, Dippy, where's Bungles?
Croft.
Oh, man, it's Dippy.
But the saddest case of all was the panda woman. Yes, half woman, half panda.
That's it. There we go. And sit you down here.
Yeah, panda woman, probably in for infertility treatment, I'm not sure. Oh, it's a panda woman. All right there. Go with some bamboo. Go on. What's that? Sweet, it's our partner. We haven't got any. I'll tell you what you might like, though. Have a look in that bag. Look. See what you think. What, I wonder, has Peter Jones from Dragon's Den been up to this week?
I'm going to urinate in a funnel.
Well, good luck with that. Yes, it's Peter's brand new format, which is not anything like Dragon's Den.
Not much.
American Inventor. Of course, it being America, things are a little more extreme.
This competition is mine. I am the American Inventor, season 2, 2007. I'm coming back with 4 yeses.
Yeah, right, calm down, mate. He looks pretty confident. Is Dusty, yeah. He's sure he's going to get 4 yeses for his special bike. Well, I say special bike. Just how special is that bike?
And I invented the A-cycle. It's the most dynamic bicycle in the world. I've put a full shield over the wheel to make it safer and more visible. Now the bicycle is 100% more safe. It's the most intense ride you'll ever take.
That bicycle is a patent-pending bicycle invented by you?
No.
Okay, he's not invented the bike. What has he invented then?
But what have you invented? My invention is the wheel.
He's invented the wheel! Third time too! Who else we got?
My name is Richard Desert Jr., and this is my father.
Hello, my name's Richard Desert Sr.
It's always nice to have a choice of desserts. What have they got up their sleeve?
Our invention is called the fire escape suit. It's a safety device that allows a person to quickly and safely escape a burning structure.
Fire escape suit, that's a good idea. I can see how that might catch on. Let's see it then.
Richard Sr., can you hear me? Okay. I'm supposed to put this on and then be running out of my house, right?
That's gonna trap fire inside it.
You can see and you can move.
The good thing about this is when you wear it in a fire, you still get burnt, but it keeps the juices in. It's a cannibal's dream! Oven-ready human, but the invention I thought was the least likely to succeed was that of Wigberto Delgado.
Okay, my name is Wigberto Delgado. I invented the urinator, and it's going to change how we use the toilet all over the world.
The urinator! Yeah. So, what's the idea behind that?
The principle is, it's for men to be able to urinate without having to lift up the toilet seat.
I've got news for you, mate. We can. Sorry, darling. Of course not. The seat goes up, the seat goes down. But which is better, the toilet seat up or the toilet seat down? Well, there's only one way to find out. Leg wax goes badly wrong on Bionic Woman.
All of you, they're making you better.
Underfloor heating turned up too high on Dog Rescue.
Turn it down.
And things get personal on Time Team.
Oh.
And within minutes, Matt Trench produces another surprise.
Slag.
Now, it was a little low cut, that top. Now, where's that cup of tea that builder was going to get me? I'm spitting feathers here. No, this was casualty and a bunch of Polish builders. Polish builders. Unusual. Yes, my Polish ain't bad, but I struggled for a while with the translation of Zaki Poot. Zaki Poot. Zaki Poot.
Zaki Poot. Zaki Poot. Zaki Poot. Zaki Poot. Zaki Poot. Zaki Poot. Zaki Poot.
Push pineapple, shake the tree. Zaki Poot. Zaki Poot. Push pineapple, shake the tree. Yeah, Polish raggedo. Zaki Poot, yeah. I suppose if you were a champion arm wrestler and you were ill, you probably still couldn't resist one last match.
Can you help him?
Of course.
Of course, it was the final bow for casualty consultant Harry Harper. And as he waved goodbye, he made sure he was waving to both the tall and the short. Which brings us to our TV highlight of the week. Surprised to see Amanda Holden recreating the title sequence from Tales of the Unexpected on Wild at Heart this week. Of course not. It wasn't Tales of the Unexpected, although there was a little unexpected. Poor old Sarah Trevanion was killed, yes, in a fire. And despite the local interest, husband Danny wanted a quiet funeral. Just family.
People have been phoning the house asking about the funeral.
Just us. Just family.
I know, but she was much loved. They want to know whether they can send flowers or maybe make a date.
Just family.
Just family. So, I was surprised to see these two gatecrashers turn up. Elephant? Giraffe? Who's that then? They're not family. The elephant there, of course, played by... Nice to see him again. It was very sad to see Amanda Holden die like that, and in a fire, too. I can't help thinking the whole thing could have been avoided.
Sarah!
flower.
Oh, lovely. Thank you.
Can you hear me, Colin?
Sorry. Oh, that's better. Thanks for that. Lovely.
Thanks, Amanda. Good luck with the opportunity in Oxford, you do. Yeah. Say hi to Paul Potts. Love the teeth. But although Sarah has died, the circle of life continues. And Jana the cheetah gave birth to a baby cheetah. Hang on a minute. I think I've seen them two before somewhere. Stacey and Stacey's mum on EastEnders. Yes, it's EastEnders, and Ian Beale was getting ready for his big visit to Buckingham Palace to meet the Queen, and so was practising his smile.
Listen, I thought I'd have a little dress rehearsal for Monday, OK? So, when I meet Her Majesty, shall I smile like this? Or like this?
Depends. You're auditioning for the Joker.
Well, you can talk. Yeah, what are the words to that Louis Armstrong classic? A wonderful, it goes, I think to myself, what a wonderful...
And I think to myself, what a wonderful...
That's right, yeah, hair. What a wonderful hair. This was Wonderland, the curious world of Frinton-on-Sea, and you should hear some of the stories. Well, pretty racy.
There's much happened here in Frinton.
But somebody did try to get over the fence between me and my next-door neighbour.
Yeah, tried to get over the fence between her and her next-door neighbour. I'm sure you're thinking, don't keep us in suspense. What was the upshot of all that? Well, pretty dramatic.
So he shuts his gate early now. Because of it, the side gate.
Shuts his gate early now. Lifestyle change. This was Margaret, who, as far as I can see, is the fastest answerer in the West. The question has barely left your lips before you got an answer.
Do you live alone, Margaret?
Yes.
0.02 of a second. See if you can better that, Margaret.
He's the only man you've ever really loved.
Yes.
0.1. Not bad. Yes, she's lived in Frinton a long time and naturally built up quite a collection of knick-knacks. Try getting a tune out of that. Eh? No, we're all going to get old. Come on, I've worked out what I'm going to look like when I'm old. Yeah. Tippy cheek. But the big story down in Frinton at the moment is the plan, and you'd better sit down for this, by the local council to remove the gates from the level crossing and replace them with a barrier. Well, there was near anarchy on the streets. Now, for an effective demo, you've got to have a catchy slogan.
What do we want? The gates. Where do we want it? No, what do we want? Where do we want it? The gates. The gates? What do we want?
Safety. When do we want it? Gates. The main beef is that the gates won't be controlled by someone in Frinton.
And it would be even better if they leave our gates alone. Instead of some lunatic at Colchester controlling them.
Guess what? I'm controlling the gates in Frinton. Up with the gates, down with the gates. Up with the gates, down with the gates. Up, down, up, down, up, down. Hello? Yeah, sorry, it won't happen again. Sorry. Sorry, off. Well, the demo spilt out onto the streets. And who says things move slowly in Frinton? Just celebrating New Year. Hey, Happy New Year! Hey.
don't know, he gets away with it. More thrillbillies than hillbillies later tonight. The Dukes of Hazzard are fighting for justice in their own unique way. Later, there's action comedy in tonight's movie at 9:30. Coming next, though, Hollywood star Jessica Alba is in the voiceover booth, joining Ant and Dec next for the Saturday Night Takeaway.
On EastEnders. Get her. Egg on a ventilator on Holby. And things get saucy on The Bill.
Come on, girl. Think of the view you'll get from the top, eh?
Well, you could take me up the London Eye with champagne instead.
Listen. Isn't it embarrassing when you're having a conversation with a work colleague, then halfway through you realise your trousers have fallen down?
By the way, well done.
Is that really all you've got to say?
Oh, what do you want me to say? No real harm was done, and you and Dr. Truman are both heroes.
We could just as easily...
Yes, this was Casualty. I was surprised to see them try to recreate Michael Jackson's Thriller in the emergency room this week.
Oh, really? No!
It's a thriller, thriller night. Someone had been dragged behind a car by a local gangster. He'd managed to escape, but when the gangster caught up with him, all hell broke loose. Although, it actually looked quite good fun.
Don't play the big man with me, pal. You won't win. This is what I do for a living.
All right, Brian, sit down and see this week, Eric. It was banging.
Oh, the good old school bundling. Which brings us to our I Beg Your Pardon of the Week.
I beg your pardon of the week.
You hang on, you follow me, I'll do something. Make yourself look sharp until I come down, won't it?
I beg your
It's time to find out what the Nutty Nosher eats this week on Freaky Eaters.
Happy in his job and engaged to be married, Andrew seems to have it all. But his life is far from normal, because for 26 years, the only thing Andrew Forster has ever eaten is biscuits.
Biscuits. Now, yeah, I'm doing it grown up now. Yeah. It's actually quite a serious problem, yeah. So it's biscuits for dinner, and he takes a packed lunch to work.
Even his packed lunch is a five-year-old's dream.
Pan of Wales, my favourites. A toffee crisp, a Kit Kat, a double-decker, shortcake thing, Mars bar.
Hang on a minute! Toffee crisp, Kit Kat, Mars bar? They're not biscuits. They're sweets. If your mum said you fancy a biscuit and gave you a Mars bar, you wouldn't be able to believe your luck. There's a very serious problem, as I say. Fortunately, his fiancée is very supportive.
I don't know why he can't eat this. I just think he's being awkward.
Yeah, well, she's got a point. She's got a point. Just how many biscuits does he eat in one year?
That's it now.
Is this serious?
It's actually 6,000 biscuits a year.
Blimey, think of the size of the cup of tea you'd need to wash that down. So the psychological treatments begin.
Andrew normally chews a mouthful of new food over 40 times before even attempting to swallow it. By distracting his childish side with a toy helicopter, Stephen wants the body's natural swallowing instinct to take over.
good.
Very. Okay. And here comes first thing, open your mouth, put it in, chew. One, two, three, keep focusing on that, and swallow, please.
Helicopter. Then TV nutritionist Natalie Savona sends Andrew home with a task to eat some fruit. Well, he didn't like that.
Try and, like, just put that in and look at me, talk to me.
Can't do it at the moment.
Can I just talk about anything in general?
Yeah.
So we're going to go out for a meal together and you're just going to focus on your food, concentrate on what you're eating. It'll be the boringest hour I'll ever had in my life.
You've obviously never watched Freaky Eaters. I suppose my favourite bit of Freaky Eaters is when they're in the cinema at the start, listening to their nearest and dearest trying to persuade them to eat a normal diet.
Hi, Andrew. I just wanted to wish you luck. It does bother me that we don't go out with friends and family or do anything because you just want to avoid the fact that we've got to have a meal.
You know, all this time, all these years that we've wasted not being able to spend time together, want to get ourselves a bit more closer. You know, we'll go out for meals together.
Hi, Andrew. It's me, Harry. Just stop eating biscuits! Just stop eating them! Stop eating back on the box. Yes. It's been 5 long years. That's a long holiday.
If you go on holiday to France, you'll have it all around the coastal areas.
Well, they are. They are a hot-blooded race, the French. But, no, of course not. She's come back renewed and invigorated with a big idea.
There are many, many people out there who are still afraid to cook, and perhaps even more who don't have time to cook.
What about those of us who pretend we can't cook in order to get someone else to cook for us? Sorry, darling. Yes, she's back. And so, whilst Jamie's digging up the latest organic produce from his garden, what fine ingredients is Delia dishing?
And what I'm going to use is actually frozen mashed potato.
I've got some cooked mince. It's been cooked with onions and flavourings, but I didn't cook it. And actually, it came from here. And these are called lightly spiced wedges.
So, how do you cook this stuff, Delia?
So they now go onto a baking tray, a nice solid baking tray. I'm going to spread them out, and they're going to go into 220 degree oven, and they're going to cook very quickly in just 18 minutes.
You just copied that off the packet. It was nice to see Delia's husband at long last, and it seems he helps her out with the recipes.
My husband Michael writes up the recipes,
which he copies off the side of the packets. But what I like to do is to play Delia's mum bingo. Yeah, I fancy a game of Delia's mum bingo now. I need a 41, a 57, a 50, an 87, a 3, and a 60. Right. Eyes down, off you go.
She was born in an air raid, guns, 41.
41, got that.
How fast were you going when you got your points?
57.
57, got that.
7 miles.
What was that?
In a 50-mile limit.
50, got that.
And I'm 87.
87? Got that. Right, all I need now is a 3 and a 60.
And I got
3 points.
3 points and 60 pounds.
Bingo! Delia's mum bingo. Very funny. I found out who does the sound at the end of the countdown tune.
It's officially more daunting than the dentist.
Ah.
You've got a coma. Have you had your eyes tested lately?
No, 20/20 vision me.
Well, that glaucoma test is something else. They fire you in the eye with a sudden puff of air, like...
Step off, Charlie. Yeah, yeah, you've got to love him. There was dramatic news on Corrie this week.
Amy's completely gone off yoghurt.
The good news is she's still drinking Yakult. Steve and Michelle fancied a night out, so got Liam to babysit. I wasn't sure about the timing, though.
So Carla didn't fancy my St. Patrick's night drink, then?
Well, we can all toast them together.
Well, I'm up for it, as long as we can find a babysit for Amy.
Liam?
Yeah, why not? In for a penny.
Excellent. Shall we say 7:30?
7:30? That's when Corrie's on. That might be needed on Corrie. Better off getting someone from Emmerdale to do it, because that's 30 minutes earlier. I was surprised to see Bill pick his nose and look at it this week on Corrie.
You want Anna?
Yeah, I'll see you later. Oh, give her our love, Audrey, and tell her I'll try and pop in again tomorrow.
Save that for later. Traditionally, of course, one should pick it, lick it, roll it, then flick it. Gail was in hospital after I fell down the stairs for her last week. Caused a lot of concern locally, but you can't dwell on these things, can you?
Well, it could have been worse. She could have been brain damaged. So what's a wheelchair in the greater scheme of things?
Are you using a wheelchair, Gail?
Yeah, she will be. On a tempera.
A couple of ice bombs, right, please.
A bit cruel, but life goes on. Fizz was back from holiday, but I'm not sure where she went. Though, if only there was some clue.
Quid pro quo.
A straw donkey, sunglasses, Holland? Finland. So with Amy's yogurt phobia, Bill's nose, Dev's noises and Fizz back in, it was very much a bogey-picking, yogurt-hating, Dev-loving, cruel fizzing Corrie.
Yeah, that was a morning work, that.
Spain, of course, wasn't it? Yeah, straw donkey Spain, yeah. See, Roy came back from his holiday a couple of weeks ago and he brought a clue back with him. Giraffe! Holland, no, Africa, yeah. So there's Fizz with a straw donkey, Roy with his toy giraffe, both nice souvenirs of a holiday, but which is better? There's only one way to find out. TV Burp. Christian does horse impression on EastEnders. Man goes nerdy at the end of a sentence on Monster Moves.
Whether that'll come home to the UK or not, we'll have to wait and see.
And woman with very long hair on A Place in the Sun.
I can't get enough of whizzing around Lisbon's coastline, feeling the wind race through my hair. It curves sleekly around the western edge of Europe, hugging 30 miles of Atlantic Ocean, embracing some of the continent's most arresting views.
That is long hair. Now, what time is it when all the numbers on your clock go on holiday and leave the number 21 to babysit?
You would have rather gone out for a bite.
No, I prefer it here.
Oh, it's 21:30. Yes, it's EastEnders. And what's the least likely thing you're ever going to hear about Walford?
Walford's lovely.
Lovely. Oh, it is nice. No, it isn't. It's horrible. I mean, some of the things you see on it. Oh. And you're thinking, how can that get any worse? Lovely. What could top that?
I'll just ignore it. Don't worry. I told him I don't want to be disturbed.
Oh, for goodness sake, just answer it, Ian.
What?
Can you stop that? It's disgusting. Okay. Bit much. So, if you live in lovely Walford, what do you do for entertainment? round. They're washing a gate. Yeah, the gate washing always draws a crowd. No, there was some more formal entertainment. Lucy Beale had a big party. Yeah, invited over 300 people. Although we only ever saw about 12. And pretty soon it turned into anarchy. Yes, absolute anarchy. The toilet paper was out and everything.
Anarchy!
Well, as you can imagine, when Ian got home, there was hell to pay.
I have had enough of this!
Get off me!
You are going to change, and I am going to make you. Do you understand me? This has got to stop! Or you can just get out. You are ruining everyone's life, including your own.
No, you ruined my life. You did when you drove out Mum.
Oh, I drove your Mum away, and your life would have been so much better if you'd have gone with her.
Yeah, actually!
Well, I wish you had!
Which brings us to our TV highlight of the week.
Watch this.
It's brilliant.
Brilliant. You know when you buy those cheap chickens, they're nice and big when you put them in the oven, but by the time they've cooked...
You know, it doesn't stack up, does it? Cooper, the obsessive stalker, preying on his pretty student.
They'll never feed two. Yes, it's Lewis, the show for people who like Inspector Morse but can't get any more Inspector Morses. It was as if he'd been bitten by a wolf.
I can't believe I let you talk me into that.
Which rebounded back in time to Dancing on Ice.
Ooh.
And ended up in Emmerdale.
Oh.
And isn't it frustrating when you put your seatbelt on too tight? Thought he was garrotted. Yeah, nasty way to go. Not as bad as this way, though.
Where's all this blood come from?
There's no nice way of saying this. Your Mr. Cooper, it appears, has been castrated.
There must be a nicer way of saying it. How about saying he can still ride his bike, but the saddlebags are no longer attached? Or the hamster's cheeks are empty, but he still sticks his tongue out. Nice ways if you think about it. Now, my mum always used to say, never talk with your mouth full.
Ah, the toothbrush! Put your hand on your head!
What are you doing here?
Kermit.
Yes, the bionic woman's back. Hooray! Yeah, she's back. But hang on, there's two of them.
Who are you?
The first bionic woman.
I think you'll find that was Lindsay Wagner in 1976. She's bionic, so she has a particular way of running. Yeah, I'm bionic. Watch. Yeah. Yeah. I'm bionic, me. Yeah. Have a look at this. Yeah. That's where they put all the electronics in. Yeah, it's a bit slow at the time, it's better now. Yeah. So, a new bionic woman. Let's hear the new spec.
You can run 60 miles per hour, maybe faster. And you have enough power in your arm to shatter brick. And you can bend steel with your grip.
That's so Superman.
You have 2020 vision, which means you can see from 2,000 feet what other people can see from 20. Your ear can isolate a conversation from 2 miles away as if it's right in front of you.
And you used to be in EastEnders. Yeah, Zoe Slater of Easties. Big name in the States. Didn't see that coming. You'll be telling me next that Dean Gaffney is the $6 million man. But all was not as it seemed for Zoe Slater of EastEnders. She'd been set up by a boyfriend. Then she discovered a secret under the floorboards.
Why, Zoe, you remember me? Any chance of getting me in there?
Dean Gaffney is the bionic man.
I was a man, barely alive, but they rebuilt me.
Shazam! Well, as it's Easter, I thought, wouldn't it be nice to remember what Easter's all about? Mm. Yeah, so please, ladies and gentlemen, welcome the Easter Bunny and his eggs!
The detectives' teams are themselves under investigation when Jack Shepherd picks out his favourite episodes in Wycliffe and Me, starting next on ITV3. Here for us, though, a touch of Hollywood glamour from Kate Hudson with Ant and Dec next. It's the last in the series of the Saturday Night Takeaway.
Dog Rescue.
Okay.
Voice of Little Britain's Andy Pipkin makes guest appearance on Doctors.
You made me feel useless. You weren't there for me.
I know that. I'm sorry.
An upper-class toilet found on Time Team.
Are we looking at a pot this big or this big?
No, probably only about this side. We've got quite a sharp shoulder and then it's going to come quite rapidly down to a base, I would say.
Is that a you and me type pot, or is that a high status knobs pot?
Oh, you know what? I'm suddenly really hungry.
Lunch, but it was a table of cleansing wipes, so I do not know what to expect for the next like couple of days. I do not know.
Oh, just a Hermes heater just to take the taste away. Yes, it's that hotbed of Nancy's, I'd Do Anything. And this week we found out who was going through to the live shows, so it was a very emotional time.
You could be Nancy. Good luck.
You could be Nancy.
Well done.
You could be Nancy.
Oh, really? Oh, thank you. Oh, thank you so, so much. It was so chubby that bit, really. Oh, I don't want to know what to say away from the line. Oh, I just, oh, oh, God. I'll go a little.
Mum? Are you telling?
I've got a screw.
Could be Nancy.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Annoying when your eel won't let go of your lemon. Let go of the lemon. Just let go. Yes, the apprentice is back. You're a lightweight. You're fired. Yes, the Rolls Royce of reality TV shows. But let's just remind ourselves of what's at stake.
They're here to fight it out for a dream job worth £100,000.
You should go on Millionaire. You get £1 million for that. Or Deal or No Deal. So, it's not great prize money, but there's the chance of working with Sir Alan Sugar. So, let's have a look at some of the contestants.
As a salesperson, I rate myself as probably the best in Europe.
What are you doing on The Apprentice, then? If you're the best salesperson in Europe, it'll be like multi-millionaire Sir Alan Sugar doing a scratch card. Who else?
I haven't failed in the traditional sense at anything, but I did get a B in one GCSE, which to me was a failure, having got straight A's throughout my whole entire school life.
Yeah, I got 19 out of 20 once for my spellings. And it still rankles. It seems I before E doesn't apply to receive, but who knew? The first task is to sell a van load of fish. And it seemed to me they didn't know much about fish at all.
I've got an amazing offer for you. And I don't want to say that quality fish here.
Look at the size of the breasts on that. They're massive.
Fish breast. Yeah. Yeah. See, I'm more of a fin man myself. They may not know much about fish, but by George, they know a lot about business. Yeah, they go to try and sell the remaining fish to a solicitor's office, and I was bowled over by their negotiating skills. He's hoping for £130. Just watch and learn.
We'll sell the whole lot to you for 100 quid, everything.
I think we should sell the whole lot at half price, £50, everything.
In a week?
No, we can't do that. Really.
Can I ask you a question? Can I ask you a question? Just one question. If we can do the whole lot for you for £80, would you do it?
No, £50.
I can't go less than £75 for the whole lot. I just think £50 is too diminutive. It's too
cheap. No, you're looking at the short term. You've got to look at the long term.
I know what I'm saying. You're saying you get
a very much time. 5 o'clock in the afternoon.
What about £65?
No. £50.
Okay, well,
the customer's always right, yeah?
Yeah, well, it's going well so far. There's still room for a little negotiation.
Right, £50 for the whole lot. Shaking his hand, £50.
That's the person you should hire, Alan. The bloke buying the fish. So, remember when we first met Nick?
I've never had a failure.
You sure, Nick?
You've got a big F. You're fine.
I blame that B. You've got a GCSE. Which brings me to the Apprentice TV highlight of the week. And if you're easily offended by standard fishmongery, look away now.
The Apprentice TV highlight of the week.
Look up your grand- granny's remote control and heartbeats back. The story of crimes that were committed in the 60s, but that we are seeing now. It was, of course, a simpler time, the 60s, a time when it was OK to pour tea into a woman's bra.
Looks like
it'll
be killed by the prosecution.
Two cups of tea. It was nice to see love blossoming between Joe and an old girlfriend who turned up unexpectedly in Aidensfield. She kissed him whilst shaving and got some shaving foam on her face.
Say goodbye.
Can't you wait until I've shaved?
I've got an appointment. New headies don't wait. Oh, I'll see you later.
Yeah, you bet.
Oh, she's going in for another kiss. She'll get. Oh, oh dear, she's got it on her.
Oh. I'll see you later.
Yeah, you bet.
No, don't do that. You'll get. Oh. More shaving foam on your face. No.
Yeah, you bet.
No, don't do that, you'll get. Yeah. She's caught in a vicious circle now.
Yeah, you bet.
I'll see you later.
Yeah. You bet. Yeah.
Just give him a kiss and sling your hook. Ridiculous. EastEnders now. And Tanya buried her husband alive this week. That's a nice feel-good story for Easter. No, the good news is she dug him up again. Yeah. Then she got into a panting competition with him. No coffin, that's cheating. It was Max's time underground that I enjoyed most, though. I don't know which was my favourite bit of Max underground. There was the bit where he grunted. But again, I did enjoy Max's underground cry of, Dad.
Dad.
Like that, or if I had to choose my favourite Max underground bit, it would probably be Max's half cry, half laugh. Hey. Oh, we've got a new one apparently. But of course, it was important for Tanya to carry on as if nothing had happened. Doubly important because it was Lauren's birthday, and amazingly, she got a card from her dad, Max.
Oh, thanks, Mum. Well, I was going to give you the money to get something yourself, but there's not much thought in that, is
oh,
there?
This one looks like it's from Dad.
Yeah, I managed to get hold of it. There it is, look. Remember that very slow bloke, Charlie Thomason, off the Royal Today I showed you a couple of weeks ago? Yeah, well, he was slow. But then there was an extra on EastEnders this week who seemed just as slow.
Silly old mum, he's still got a girlfriend, remember?
Yeah, they're both slow, but which is the slowest? The slow extra on EastEnders or slow Charlie Thomason on the Royal Today? Well, there's only one way to find out. Woman with one white foot and one black foot on alternative therapies.
And will it help the asthma as well?
It's going to help your lungs to
R2-D2's dad turns up on Emmerdale.
You're right.
And singing Coffin on Casualty.
From glen to glen and down the mountainside, the sun's gone.
Yeah, just forget it, lads, all right. It's too late. Go on. No, that way. I'll tell you what you don't see enough of on TV. A three-legged deer attacking a video camera. It's nice to see. This was Johnny's New Kingdom, which follows West Country legend Johnny Kingdom as he attempts to film wildlife with a camcorder, whilst being filmed by a proper camera crew. Yeah. He doesn't do it all with his camcorder. No. He's got a couple of hidden cameras, too.
Just look at the screen when it comes on. Now, what do you think that is?
I've no idea, mate. This week, Johnny introduced us to the world of the dormouse. And what does the dormouse like to do for a holiday?
But before you go to the expense of buying loads of nest boxes, we use these nesting tubes, because dormice will camp in these.
Yeah, usually go camping. Yeah. Yeah. And they could use a mobile phone cover as a rucksack. There's a rucksack for a dormouse. And inside there, he's got half a cotton bud soaked in petrol as a torch. As a sleeping bag, he uses a child's sock. And then, as a tent, what he can do is use a lady's bra. Like that. There's two little tents there for them. But first, on the floor of the tent, for extra comfort, he puts a panty liner. But I haven't got one of those. Johnny asks all the right questions, though.
Yeah, why is this one so steep?
Because the branch is steep.
You do have to be careful with dormice, though, as they're protected species. Not just anyone can handle them.
To disturb a dormouse in its nest is unlawful, unless you have a licence.
Yeah, yeah, see, I'm licensed to disturb a dormouse. Yeah, there's the licence, there's my licence. Given by the DDLA, Licence to Disturb Dormouse Authority. Although I got 3 points on it after I disturbed a dormouse and it made a complaint, but it was quite a sharp stick. 11 points on your licence, you can't disturb dormice no more. No, you have to go back to disturbing field mice, which is nowhere near as much fun. Johnny's got his own idea of how to attract dormice.
Nice to
see you.
Bye-bye. But you know, he thinks my tennis balls won't work. But I'm going to put some food in mine, some nuts and some raisins.
To our most casual turning on of a car indicator of the week.
Most casual turning on of a car indicator of the week.
We're going in just to get them and bring them back to the centre. It does make me angry.
Most casual turning on of a car indicator of the
is back, and this time he's trying to fly over Mount Everest on a paramotor. It's an ambitious project, but safety first.
I'd always planned this project to be ambitious but safe. The bottom line is, it's ambitious, but it's not safe.
But one out of two ain't bad. Bear's working with his pal Gilo, who's worked up a special motor that goes on his back to help him fly. So, it must be pretty heavy.
Gilo puts the equivalent of a small man and a 100-horsepower car engine on his back.
It's pretty heavy. Let's see if we can take off. Come on. Flap your arms. Flap your arms. Give us a hand here. No. No. Oh, that is heavy. And Gilo has to modify the engine to enable it to fly at high altitudes.
As well as the weight of the paramotor, they're carrying 45 pounds of fuel, oxygen, communications kit and cameras. In total, it's 168 pounds, the equivalent of carrying a super middleweight boxer on your back.
Wind up, Gilo! Right then, come on! Flap your arms, Ricky. Give us a hand. Come on, flap them. No, it's no use. It's not working.
Well, how am I going to get on then?
I don't know. How'd you get here? It's not my problem, is it? Yeah. Thanks, Ricky. Nice shorts. So, let's see how Bear Grylls got on.
Takeoff is the hardest moment. If the wind fluctuates, the wing won't inflate properly. If the engine speed isn't perfect, it won't launch.
He's managed to clear most of the leaves from the surrounding area. But all credit to Bear, he pulls it off. So, Gilo, what's your next big idea?
I've got lots of things I really want to do as soon as I get back to England. Flying cars have always been a big dream of mine.
Flying cars. Yeah, good luck with that. It's just the sort of thing you might see on Peter Jones' brand new format show, American Inventor, which, unlike Dragon's Den, requires people to get backing for their inventions. So, what you got for us this week?
I'm Joe Sparks, inventor of the Easy Run Belt. This actually teaches you to run while you're running.
You haven't thought that through, have you? But you know how there are loads of superheroes around us who protect us from wrongdoers, but there's not a superhero whose one goal is to protect just children.
My name is Silvio De Salvatore, and I created and invented the first superhero who has one goal, and that goal is to protect children. This is Black Cougar.
Your invention is a cat.
No.
Exactly, it's not a cat, it's Black Cougar, who has one goal, and one goal only, to protect children. So, don't for 1 minute think that it's his mate Mike dressed up.
Thank you very much.
But,
Wait!
The two of us didn't vote, you didn't let us vote.
Huh?
Well, he said no and he said no.
Sometimes they talk us out of our nose.
Oh, is that how it works? Hey, Mikey, Black Cougar, come here.
Mikey, Black Cougar, of course. Ah, Black Cougar. Just what we need to protect our children. Welcome him now, ladies and gentlemen. It's Black Cougar! I mean, Black Cougar.
Don't worry, people often make that mistake.
See you next week. Bye.
Next on ITV1.
Mr. Wonka, I'm Bella Bobo.
Oh. I don't care.
ITV1 movie premiere, Charlie and the Chocolate Factory, is next.
In the present series of TV Burp, Dirty Boy Trouser Ariel on American Inventor.
Fortunately for Khalid, his invention.
Dirty Boy! Squirrel with dandruff on Doctors. And thirsty Tony and Benjamin disappointed on the bill.
Would you like to sit down? I won't offer you a cup of tea if you don't mind.
You said there'd be a cup of tea.
I thought it would be.
It was Michael Aspel's last Antiques Roadshow. Shame. Yeah, he's retired from the show, but not from show business, although Hugh Scully gave it up and sank without a trace. What I always loved about the Antiques Roadshow was the heartwarming family stories behind the antiques.
This is a nice photograph. Is this elegant lady a member of your family?
No, she killed my mother's dog.
I'm sure she had her reasons. Sunday's show was turned into a wonderful farewell to Michael, complete with some fascinating Michael facts. Michael has clocked up more than 50,000 roadshow miles. He's met close to 40,000 people and signed almost as many autographs. Yeah, that's just the start of it. It does go on. Over the course of making Antiques Roadshow, Michael has got drunk in over 200 different travel lodges. And for a month lived solely on Ginster's pork pies. Michael likes to steal the antiques worth the most money and has 99% positive feedback on eBay. Yeah, well, we don't need any more of that, I don't think. Yeah. Here, I wonder what Sir Alan Sugar's up to.
Hello, girls. How's my pants doing?
Yes, it's week two of The Apprentice.
You touch my fence again, I'll give you a witty. I am Sir Alan Sugar, and one of you will be fired.
Thanks, mate. Yes, it's only week two, and Sir Alan was particularly fussy about his laundry.
I've laid on two laundries for you. You go out, you find the customers, you perform the service, and most certainly make sure the quality's right, because I'll tell you one thing. When stuff comes back from the laundry that I don't like, I sling it back at them.
All right, Sir Alan, sorry.
Yeah. Might need a bit of vanish on those. Yeah, because Sir Alan doesn't go for the designer gear. No, he goes for the cheap copies from the markets. He doesn't wear Calvin Klein pants. No, he has a cheaper sound alike.
I'm going to phone the 24-hour hotline to see the progress on my Calvin Kleins.
Yeah, Calvin Kleins. Yeah. That's why he's so rich. He saves money by buying hooky gear. Yeah, I've got his pants here. There they are. Calvin Klein. Then he's got his fake Nike trainers. There they are. He bought his wife some Christine Dior perfume. And then he's got his fake Louis Vuitton bag. They're Louis Sweetcorn. Louis Sweetcorn. That wasn't a real thing. Now, the girls, led by Jenny, were off knocking on doors trying to drum up some trade. And I was surprised to hear Lady Thatcher wasn't interested in helping these young entrepreneurs.
Good morning.
Hello. Good afternoon.
We've just set up a new company and we're looking to do washing and ironing for people so they don't have to bother on a weekend.
Not interested.
All right, thank you.
That's not fair, actually, because I do all Lady Thatcher's laundry.
All right. Sorry, Maggie. Well, there's her pants look.
David Cameron. David Cameron on the front and Brown on the back. Didn't mean it in that way. Team leader Jenny wasn't impressed with Shazia and Lucinda. She felt she had to spoon-feed a couple of them. That is the right expression, isn't it? Spoon-feeding?
For the entire process that I've been working with both of you, it has felt like I've had to breastfeed you.
All that talk of breastfeeding, I fancy a rusk now. Well, I must say, I have been enjoying the new series of daytime DIY show 60 Minute Makeover. If you're unfamiliar with the format, it's a surprise makeover like changing rooms, but, and here's what singles it out, it all takes place in 60 minutes. Although, if you take out the adverts, the show is in fact only 46 minutes long. So, you can imagine, 46 minutes, it's got to be a fairly shoddy job. This week on 46 Minute Makeover, Victoria did it on her mum, Margaret. And what was her motivation?
In On The Secret today is daughter Victoria. Why do you want to do this for your mum?
Because I can't be bothered to do it myself. Now, be fair, her mum has had health problems, a condition affecting her eyes.
She's very, very busy. She never has any time to do this makeover. A few months back, she was actually diagnosed with glaucoma, so her eyesight hasn't been great.
Well, that might come in handy a little later on. It is shoddy work. But of course, when Mum Margaret got home from her trip to find the 46-minute makeover team outside her house, she was most excited. It made her voice go a little bit high.
Well,
set this up!
Quite high. Can't get any higher than that.
Wow, it's bright. It's not great.
Surely that's as high as it can go. Yeah, that might get annoying. But with only 46 minutes to do the makeover, I'm just a bit worried about the standard of the work. I mean, what happens when they all go home? Which brings us to our TV Expert of the Week.
TV Expert of the Week.
Adam Crew will test a model building on an earthquake simulator. To make it realistic, this model is built with spaghetti.
Gail on Corrie had developed a new invention, the arm kitchen roll dispenser.
Of course he is, Gail, I know that.
Thanks, Gail. Good luck with it. Deb's daughter Amber seems to be picking up some of her dad's traits. It starts with a rather squeaky mouth.
I've been in plenty of pubs, me. I just...
Yeah. Yeah, squeaky mouth. And before you know it, you've got the full Dev. But the big story, of course, was Paul and Leanne burning down Velandro's, the Italian restaurant. And it was important they got their story straight.
What if I say she wasn't, and then I speak to her and she says she was?
You don't have to say that she wasn't, just don't say she was.
But if you say she was and she wasn't, and you say she was and she wasn't, and she was and she says she wasn't, and she wasn't and she says he was and she wasn't, then who was?
What if I say she wasn't, and then I speak to her and she says she was?
You don't have to say that she wasn't, just don't say she was.
Well, I'd say she wasn't, and you say she was.
You don't have to say that she wasn't, just don't say she was.
I wasn't. Well, it wasn't just Paul and Leanne involved in the arson attack, no. I believe she got a little black furry monkey to help her out. You know, the little black furry monkey that hangs onto her back.
I've got the full...
Mmm.
said she was, and he said she was, and he wasn't. And she was, and he wasn't, and she said she was, and he wasn't. But who was?
Meanwhile, Vernon was planning to change the Rover's return menu. Surely that puts Betty's hot pot at risk.
We're not getting rid of Betty's hot pot.
Is that what he's proposing? Mm. Is the jerk chicken named after you?
Hot pot compared to a shank.
Yeah, I mean, I like Betty's hot pot. And I like the idea of Vernon's name shank. But which is better?
There's only one way to find out.
Tommy Cooper hair on Johnny's New Kingdom.
And this is all
just like that. Just... Horse gets angry on owner's behalf on Heartbeat.
You're a weakling. Deserve everything you get.
And a man falls in love with a silver car on The Bill. I wonder what Dean Gaffney's been up to since he appeared on TV Burp. To be bad, good to be bad, hello, hello. Yes, this was Ghost Hunting with I'm a Celebrity, which featured the stars, and I use the term lightly, of I'm a Celebrity, Get Me Out of Here. And Dean was good value because he was so easily frightened. He's filming himself screaming. Then it was time for the ghosts to talk to us.
Please, Jack, if this is you, can you perhaps give us your initials? It doesn't matter. I'm trying to work out. That looks like a J.
Yeah. Let's have a go with it, shall we? Yeah. Let's see if any ghosts can talk to us. Voice. Pulling over there, Mr. Ghost. Oi, let's pull over there. Oh, he's coming back towards me. Oh, in the way. And down. Oh, and the ghost is going round. Oh, what's that, Mr. Ghost? Oh, over to the right. Oh, I'm back there. Oh, yep. Yeah. Oh, it's another J. J. Yeah. He's got J on the brain, that ghost. Last week, we showed you R2-D2's dad on Emmerdale.
All right.
This week on David Attenborough's Tiger Spy in the Jungle, I spotted R2-D2's grandma. Nice to see the whole family in work. This was a hidden camera show for animals and turned up some amazing shots.
With a tiger in their midst, monkeys have at least one way to show their disgust.
There were some great shots of the tigers, particularly the dominant male, Charger.
This is Charger, the father of the cubs. Worryingly, he got his name from his readiness to charge.
Oh, I thought he was called Charger because you could use him to charge your mobile phone. On Casualty this week, a patient was busy trying to recreate that old Phil Collins hit, In the Air Tonight, with a paper towel dispenser. Nurse Kelsey was upset because her date stood her up.
What if he did turn up last night? He didn't. What if he saw me, took one look and thought, what a minger?
Well, it's not entirely beyond the bounds of possibility. But I wonder wonder what a child would be like if Bill Bailey mated with a Rice Krispie. A bit like that, I suppose. The Bill Bailey Rice Krispie hybrid. Well, as it's the last in the series, as a special treat to myself, let's find out what the Nutty Nosher is eating on this week's Freaky Eaters.
The fear of fruit and veg is so extreme she can only eat one thing. Helen is addicted to pasta.
Pasta!
When pasta isn't available, Helen's alternatives of cheese...
Cheese! Wheezy-wheezy-wheeze-wheeze!
Chips.
Chippy-chip!
Chocolate.
Chuck-a-wok, chonk-chonk, chucky-wocky-winky-wok, chuck-a-mock, moco, coco, maloka, diva, machiva, weezer, leezer, tabby, warby, Terence Trent, darby, chucky-man!
Bread.
And bread. Yeah, many pasta. No, actually, I'm not going to do frequencies this way. I just wanted to do that bit. Talking of food, I wonder where Delia Smith is right now.
Well, I'm in the freezer section of a supermarket.
Yeah, I thought you might be. Well, next stop, wines and spirits. No, of course not, no. What was she working on this week?
I can make one of my favourite recipes in no time at all. And one of my favourite recipes is hummus.
Mimus?
You have to cook them for about 2 or 3 hours to get them soft enough to make hummus.
Hummus?
The most important thing to serve with hummus...
Wimus?
Hummus is made from chickpeas.
Oh, hummus. Yeah. Why do you say so? Yeah. She makes hummus with frozen chickpeas because that's a big thing this series. Yeah, recipes from ready-made stuff. If that's the case, Delia, why don't you just buy a pot of hummus? Who makes hummus? That's why she's calling it hummus. It's short for who bothers to make hummus. The week before, she made a sort of frozen fish toasty.
So, just another 3 minutes and it'll be ready to serve. So we've had 5 minutes on one side of the fish, 5 minutes on the other side, 3 minutes on the sauce, straight out of the freezer, straight out of the store cupboards.
And straight into the bin. I'll have some hummus when I get home. On Animal Rescue this week, we caught up with Michaela Strachan, who was busy strangling a grebe.
This bird is a Western grebe.
Get off me, I can't breathe. For pity's sake, I'm feeling dizzy.
Poor grebe. Yeah. I was very sad to hear of this case.
Sometimes owners decide they can no longer spend the time and money to look after their sick or injured animals. All too often, these pets end up being dumped. That's what's happened to Ant and Deck.
They're sad. Yeah, Ant and Deck. Poor abandoned. I just hope they'll be able to find a home for them. That's why I've put together this little appeal.
Ant and Deck have been abandoned. Do you have space for 2 tiny people in your house? Preferably near a wine bar. All they need is a shoebox each to sleep in and somewhere to keep their awards. Please think about giving a home to ITV1's funniest entertainers, Ant and Deck.
Just one last thing I found out about Ant and Deck from Animal Rescue.
We believe that Ant is Deck's son.
Oh, I didn't know that. Well, what a week for EastEnders, then. Ricky and Bianca were back. Ricky! Yeah, Ricky's back. In fact, there were so many old EastEnders stars in this week's EastEnders that it was almost like watching an episode of The Bill. Another old face that we haven't seen since 1945 was Hitler, who now runs a cafe on the outskirts of Walford. He's put on a bit of weight, and to be honest, I would never have recognised him.
So he goes off on one, doesn't he? Spills his drink over, and then face oak over there, starts yelling at us, telling us to get out. He can't do that. Oi, Hitler!
For me? Yeah, naughty Hitler. Of course, all these old faces were brought together to celebrate Frank Butcher's funeral. His daughter Diane was there.
I'm starting nursing training next month.
Oh, great.
My partner's just qualified as a doctor.
Oh, so you settled down then?
Yeah. Nearly 3 years now.
Oh,
What's his name? Suzanne.
Funny name for a bloke. And one other old friend of Frank's. Your shoes are killing me.
I'll take her.
Oh, thank you, Clark. I'll just stop hitting you. It seems Frank Butcher, on his deathbed, made one last gesture to ex-wife Pat. He left her a special gift.
Why didn't you tell me Frank was ill?
We did.
I mean, before he died.
You
had no right to keep it a secret from me.
Yeah, but Dad said that you...
I should have been allowed to say goodbye.
He wanted to remember you with a smile on your face.
Must have a good memory. So, what was it, this gift? Well, it was Frank's old revolving bow tie. With Frank gone, it all proved too much for Pat. Well, almost.
I can't cry. I wish I could, but I can't.
Oh, go on, Pat, have a good cry. I can't. Yes, you can. I can't. I wish I could fly. I talk to the sky, yes, I can't. You can.
I can't.
I wish I could see. What folks see in me, but I can't. You can.
I can't.
Yes, nothing that you can say will change our feeling today. You know that we'll never part. Now hear what I'm saying, Pat.
Yes,
I'm your best friend.
You are.
I'm gonna help you mend your broken heart.
Broken heart.
Tomorrow at 10.
Just a bog-standard pizzeroni, mate, that a road sweeper might order, or a vet, or one of the sugar babes.
What toppings?
I'll have ham and caviar.
And I'll have pineapple and pheasant.
It's the brand-new show, Headcases. But next on ITV1, it's the last in a series of Duel, whilst over on ITV2, Liar Liar.